I'm going to talk about a literary episode in the history of Russian-Jewish relationships, namely the representation of Jewish characters in the stories of Varlam Shalamov. Shalamov had spent almost two decades in the Soviet concentration camps and then wrote about them. He was neglected for a long time, but now he is recognized not only as one of the two major Gulag writers, but also as a classic of modern Russian literature. The other major Gulag writer is, of course, Alexander Solzhenitsyn. Solzhenitsyn was often, and not without reason, suspected of antisemitism, or at least of a lack of sensitivity to the Russian-Jewish predicament. No such suspicion can be leveled at Shalamov. In his autobiographical tale, The Fourth Vologda, Shalamov recollects how his father, an Orthodox, a Russian Orthodox priest, took him to see a synagogue. It must have been the famous wooden synagogue of Vologda, which was repurposed after the revolution and pulled down in the 1960s. So he took him to the synagogue and said, "This is a prayer house of the people of a different faith. A synagogue is the same as a church, and God is one." The Jewish characters in the works of Shalamov, like all his characters, are no saints. But they are morally flawed, not as representatives of the Jewish people, but as individuals. And I shall talk about two stories. One is called The Descendant of a Decembrist, and the other, Captain Tolly's Love. The protagonist of The Descendant of the Decembrist is Sergei Lunin, a camp doctor, a prisoner. Works as a doctor, though he had not finished. He was arrested while still a student. He boasts of being a descendant of Mikhail Sergeyevich Lunin, who had been arrested together with the Decembrists in 1825. The Decembrists were a group of the members of the gentry who rebelled against Tsar Nicholas I. And five of them were hanged, and many others were imprisoned, got very harsh prison sentences. By the way, the scholars now say that Mikhail Lunin did not have any legitimate children, but Sergei Lunin, the hero of Shalamov's story, is actually a real person, one way or another. So every school child in Russia knows the story about the high-born wives of some of the Decembrists who followed their husband to Siberia and settled near their hard labor prisons, despite all the harsh circumstances. Shalamov's story also has such a self-sacrificing woman, but she is a Jew, Edith Abramovna. She is not a prisoner, but a contract medical nurse and a member of the party. So her standing is actually higher than Lunin's. She falls in love with Lunin and compromises her standing by living with him. She's expelled from the party. Nevertheless, she manages to get him an early release, to get him reinstated in Moscow University so that he can complete his medical degree. Then she gets him well-paying medical jobs in Siberia. Still, he divorces her, and she commits suicide. The first person narrator of this story says that he caught a glimpse of her once and she struck him as beautiful. At sleepless nights, he keeps recollecting her face. The other story, Captain Tolly's Love, is set against the background of a punitive camp in Kolyma, a kind of a gulag inside the gulag, where people suffer enormous hardships and humiliations all the time. It is told by an unnamed first-person narrator whom we can associate with Shalamov himself, so we can call him Shalamov in inverted commas. He enters an amicable relationship with an old prisoner, Isai Rabinovich, who holds soft jobs because he managed to bribe the right people. Now, one evening, Rabinovich wants to talk to him, and the narrator, call him Shalamov, forces himself to listen. This is an ethical act because he is exhausted and wants to sink into sleep. Rabinovich tells him that he has just got a letter from his family in Moscow saying that his daughter wants to marry the American naval attaché, Captain Tolly, and she is asking her father's permission to the marriage. And there follows this dialogue. The Shalamov says, "So run to the camp director and apply for permission to send an express letter." "But I don't want to give my permission for the marriage. That's exactly what I wanted to consult with you about." I was simply dumbfounded by these letters, these stories, this act. "If I agree to the marriage, I will never see her again. She'll go away with Captain Tolly." "Listen, Isai Davidovich, you are going to be 70 soon. I consider you a reasonable person." "This is only what I feel. I have not thought about the matter yet. I'll send the answer tomorrow." Next day, Rabinovich sends the permission to the marriage. It is interesting that Shalamov refers to his wish to consult him not as a question, but as an act, because this is indeed an ethical act. The permission is not really necessary, but the family has respected the father's feelings by asking him for this permission, which is traditional, but again, not necessary. The right response to certain situations is an inner conflict. One of the terms of this conflict does not need to be brushed away. Because the father is a powerless prisoner does not mean that his paternal feelings should not be taken into account. And the family actually respects them by sending this request, and he acts accordingly. He maintains the conflict by consulting a trusted companion about it. And the companion does not say, "You will not see her anyway." He understands that the situation has to be marked somehow, celebrated somehow. So he says, "We have to celebrate. How? Maybe we shall eat our porridge before our soup, rather than the other way around." This is another case of the motifs of reversal in this story. It is as if the ethical sophistication of these two people resonates with each other, even though they could not be more different in other ways. Now, earlier in the same story, Rabinovich singles out Shalamov because he says, "You must be a good person because you never say filthy things about women." Shalamov probably shares this criterion with Rabinovich, but he has one more. For him, judging by the story I discussed previously and some others, expressions of antisemitism are signs of moral depravity. Lunin, for instance, explains his divorce by saying, "She has a lot of relatives, like all the kikes. That doesn't suit me." Now, Lunin steals alcohol from the prison hospital for his booze parties. Worse, in order to brag of his skills as a surgeon, he operates for stomach ulcers on 12 exhausted skeletal people, the so-called dachadyagi, just to show how good a surgeon he is. Of course, they all die because they are too weak to survive the operation. Antisemitism and moral depravity are not causally related. However, one may be a kind of a signal of the other, which it is for Shalamov as well as for a number of other Russian writers, by the way. And I think that this is not what is called philosemitism. It is actually a sign of ethical refinement, ethical sophistication, which all of Shalamov's works express in one way or another.